Good afternoon, everyone. This is Gabby Gianni and
Emery Gianni.
And hey, Johnny Five, can I see you? And we're chilling out here. We have a second part of the interview with Vicente Molina. She's going to be talking about food allergies. She's going to be talking about the most common food allergens, as well as why we actually get allergies or why we have allergic reactions. So check it out.
Great. I wanted to talk a little bit about food allergies because I know how big this is and how big of an issue it is. I mean, where do we even start?
Okay. Well, our book on that is called The Food Allergy Survival Guide, and it also is a continuing education course for dietitians. And I found it very, very interesting. I have food allergies myself to dairy and eggs, which, of course, I don't eat anyway, but also possibly some sensitivity to wheat. And my son has allergies to nuts. And so I've been really interested in, you know, how allergies work. And then also, some people have a lot of allergies. And if they have a leaky gut situation, they've probably ended up being sensitive to all sorts of foods while their intestines kind of leaky and letting proteins just filter through that shouldn't be getting through. So anyway, we did the Food Allergy Survival Guide, leaving out the top 8 allergens. And this is a vegan book, and it is missing all the top 8 allergens. And do you have any idea what those allergens might be? The top 8?
Yeah, so I'm gonna take a guess here. I'm gonna say wheat.
Yep.
Or gluten. I'm going to say dairy.
Yeah.
I'm going to say nuts.
Yeah.
Soy.
Yeah.
Let's see here. Wheat, dairy, nuts, soy. I'm drawing a blank now. But
okay, by fish.
And fish, okay.
Fish. Yeah. And eggs.
Eggs, okay.
And peanuts, which are a legume, but...
Yeah.
They're in a little class by themselves. So anyway, those are the top 8 allergens. And they're the top 8 in North America, in Europe, in Canada, or just, you know, across the United States. And so what we did in the Food Allergy Survival Guide was leave out all of those allergens. And then we created really good recipes that were tasty and nutritious and created menus. So it's quite reassuring because people could do a meal for their family, for their child, for themselves, that is missing the top allergens, whichever combination they might have, and it's still got some good nutrition in it. And so that was quite fun and an adventure. And we also looked, and this is with the help of a vegan medical doctor, Michael Cropper, who's at True North Health Clinic, I was working on the vegan health study in Hawaii with him, and it's a real honor and privilege to do that. And he just told me a lot about the digestive tract and absorption. He's fascinating and really knowledgeable about that. And chapter 2 in this book is based on what he told me, so Dr. Michael Clapper. And it was all about how our gastrointestinal tract ties in with allergies, because a lot of our immune system is in that stretch of digestive tract in our body. So what we did there was look at, okay, here are the things you can eat instead, you know, that'll kind of fill the bill as far as meals go.
Great. And what, maybe so some people can understand, I mean, what is happening when, say, someone who's allergic to soy eats it? So what exactly is the physiological process that's happening, or dairy or whatever? Yeah.
Yeah, good question. There's two kinds of reactions that can happen in a broad sense. So one is actually a true allergy, and that means our immune system kicks in. And you eat some soy, and it gets into your system, and it's like a foreign protein, a protein invader. And your body, this being equated, I thought, quite in a picturesque way, Don Quixote, who used to apparently run at windmills. He thought that they were knights that he had to attack. Like, your body goes, oh, there's this terrible protein, and I have to get it. And so a lot of the harmful symptoms that you have are because your body's doing this attack mode against something that it actually isn't that harmful. So it's the reaction that causes the problem, and the immune system reaction. Now, we can determine whether somebody has that kind of sensitivity, allergy, a true allergy, by lab tests, although the lab tests are fraught with errors, and there can be 5 to 50% false positives and false negatives in different tests, but there aren't tests that are really, really accurate. So the way to really tell is leave it out for a couple weeks and then reintroduce it and see if all the horrible symptoms come back. And, of course, some people, if they leave it out, they find it feeling a lot better. They don't want to reintroduce it. They're like, okay, I'm going on without that food. Now, the tricky part is when we aren't quite sure what it is. And so what we've put in the Food Allergy Survival Guide is kind of like a Bible for how to do to approach food allergies. You can have a few food diet that includes the least allergenic foods, which tend to be grains, of course, gluten-free grains, things like rice and millet, and some vegetables, but not the nightshade vegetables, not potatoes and tomatoes and so on, and squash, a bit of that, and some fruits, which would be maybe pears and cranberries, things that don't tend to cause problems. So you could have, like, a rice cake with applesauce or pear sauce on it. Like, your diet's quite limited, but we told people how to make it, so you can at least manage for 2 weeks on that. And then, after this limited few foods diet, which also has some lentils in it, then you start reintroducing things. And mm-hmm. You'll try dairy, or if you're eating dairy, or you'll try soy, or you'll try whatever. And if you get a reaction, then you know to leave that one out. And you only introduce something new every 2 or 3 days. Now, I said that was one type of broad category of reaction. The other type is called food intolerances. And together, these are called food sensitivities. So we've had food allergies and we've got food intolerances. And together, these are called food sensitivities. So the intolerances are kind of different because they don't involve the immune system. However, they can also make us feel bad. Like, we can get a number of different symptoms, things like headaches or dermatitis or stomach upsets, gastrointestinal problems, then a number of different reactions. And the reactions you get are not all that different, whether it's a true allergy or an intolerance. But the intolerances, we can't detect them from the lab test, even though lab tests are kind of fraught with errors anyway, but you can't even determine them from that. So the tricky thing about allergies is that it's very, very hard to tell exactly what's going on. And also, even what reaction you have can be affected by the weather or how much of a certain thing you ate. You know, did you just have a little tiny bit of gluten in a muffin where they use mostly gluten-free grains, or, you know, there could be amounts that are problematic or not, and your general state of health. So you could have a little bit of something one day and a lot of something a week later and get a reaction one time and not the other. So anyway, or you could be feeling really well one day and it's not very, very much can tell you off balance. But the whole thing about determining what you're sensitive to takes some detective work, and probably detective work that you can do better than any lab or doctor. And so we've told people in the Food Allergy Survival Guide how to do that, you know, how to go through the detective work.
Your question of the day is this: do you have a food allergy? Go ahead and post it down below. This is Kevin Gianni and...
Hey.
Where are you? And Johnny Five? No, he's not into it. Together we can change the health of the world, one show at a time.